Please welcome Richard Swinenberg and Eddie Willems for the most entertaining presentation I've ever seen.
Also the most senior one, but
okay. So,
hey, welcome everybody. Just before we start, we're going to show a movie, which is actually the foundation why we actually made this presentation. I hope you can properly see it. It's actually a movie from a security company in the Netherlands, but of course, given IoT and everybody trying to do smart, they keep making the same mistakes. And actually, that is the whole thing about our presentation. Oops, it happened again. If you don't know me, my name is Richard Swinenberg, 32 years in the industry. I like the phrase what Vesselin once said, if you want to know more about me, Google me. I was 9 behind, but I was behind computers. Something happened here. This was actually my first one. It was really a nice one. Okay, this is what you get.
Oops. Yeah, well, that's normally...
Oops, it happened again. System update. Good. And we have Eddie.
Yeah, okay. Oh my God, that was a rush, isn't it? Anyway, yes, well, I think you all know me, and you can Google me as well, of course. I'm also a long time in the industry, actually, and I'm behind computers since way too long, actually. This was my first one, which was actually a calculator, but I got this one afterwards, and it was so nice, actually, but yeah. Anyway, I wrote a couple of books, actually. Well, actually one book, but it was translated to several languages. And actually, there is an English version. And, well, you know, here's the one. So if you have a very good question afterwards, you may have it.
It's enough for the shameless book plug. Just give it away.
Oh, come on. Okay, we'll see who gets that. Okay, come on. Anyway, so what are we going to do? First of all, very important, memories, you know. Are there any historical guys in the room? No, nothing? So go back with me 30 years ago, something like that. What did you do? Okay, for some people it's very difficult, I know. What did you do? Well, we were actually doing something completely different, actually. But anyway, at some point, in 1986, 1984, depending how you look at it, everything was suddenly changed by viruses. Unbelievable, isn't it? Yeah. And that's actually the reason why you were all over here. Strange, isn't it? Yeah. Well, maybe not completely, but anyway. So, those are the old days. But let's go back to the real thing. Let's start with the real presentation. Let's go back to malware and what they all say about malware. It's always something new in the news. Are there any journalists, by the way, in the room? No? Oh, shit. Okay. Anyway, so ransomware. That's actually a recent phenomenon.
Is it?
Yeah, well, is it? Well, I don't know. That's actually what, you know, a couple of years, the journalists asked me. They asked me, actually, wow, WannaCry, look at this. This is impossible, you know. How this is spreading? Come on, Eddie, this is the first time this is something we see over here. Well, I told them, well, not really, because this is... let's go back to 1989. When I actually received a diskette, a floppy. And actually these days, I need to explain what a floppy is. Yeah, that's also another problem. But I received, I was working in an insurance company, I received a floppy, and I put it in my computer. It was asking me some strange questions to find out if I was belonging to a group who could be infected by AIDS, the AIDS biological virus. And of course, that was not the case. So anyway, I tried in everything, I put in everything, every information. And suddenly, after a couple of days, actually, there was, well, something like a blocking factor on my system. It was blocking my whole computer. And it was asking me to send $189 in to a PO box. So unbelievable, you know? But that's exactly what we see these days, isn't it? Yeah.
Well, we even got a picture from it, from the screen.
Yeah, that's right. That's the one. Yeah, because you always see the wrong one, actually. I've seen that some people, and in the beginning I got another picture, and some other people seems to be looking at our presentation. They took that picture from that presentation. This is the real one, actually.
Yeah.
But anyway.
It's actually really funny that you mentioned that, because I'm a science fiction fan. And so you actually referenced Doctor Who.
Yes.
Which is, and you can see Eddie had it, but because of the Doctor Who conference, which is of course the World Health Organization, but I think you should be in a TARDIS and take it away.
Yeah, sure.
But I actually can tell you that for me, 1989 was not the very first ransomware.
That's what you think.
With a twist, you can actually go to Brain. 1986, the Elphi brothers. Remember, pretty old virus, it has some functionalities of ransomware. Well, if you remember the boot sector, there is a message in there, contact us for vaccination. And if you paid them, basically you had to pay the license fee, they would remove it. And actually, if you really want, Mikko is not here, but in 2011, the 25th anniversary of Brain, Mikko actually went to India, to Pakistan, and he found the brothers. There's a really nice interview online. The link is there. We will share the presentation, so you can look up the whole video and the interview with the brothers. It's really nice. They are actually still alive. They even sent me a mail, or sorry, a postcard, BrainNet. Mikko was there, and he had, like, for all the CARA members, a postcard to be sent, including the even the advertisement, sorry, the signatures of the guys. And how was Mikko able to find them that quickly? They are still living at the same address. Right now, they actually run a reputable business, an ISP, which is really fun. And then I started to look back 1986 as ransomware, and then actually we found another ransomware case, which happened in 1985, an insurance company in New York, where the system administrator programmed a logic bomb in the database. If he would be fired and not connecting with his account for 30 days, or his account was deleted, the database got encrypted. And you had to pay $11,086. I didn't get the $86, but that is actually the oldest version of ransomware we could find, and this guy actually got convicted in 1988, 3 years later. So it is actually a fun thing. So ransomware, although we say it is new, and or relatively new, and it keeps happening, it actually happened way before. So let's move to a different topic, like fileless malware.
Yeah, fileless malware. Again, the same thing happening. You know, again, journalists are calling me. And they told me, well, something like a year ago, oh, wow, 2018 was this. Rosina B. Yeah, it was very strange that journalists are calling me for something like this. But anyway, sometimes it happens. And they asked me, well, fileless malware, this is also something new. And, okay, I'm not going to give all the details over here.
They know it.
Because otherwise, you know it. You can find it anyway. But I thought, come on. No, this is not new again. We can go back even to, well, a couple of years before, PowerLeaks, for instance. It got, well, not similar possibilities, but anyway, it's even then, I told that as well to the journalist. I told them, well, but there is more, you know? We can go back much further in time. Let's do that. And we have that. This reminds Slammer. Oh my God, this reminds me about a very small story, you know. During the Slammer outbreak, you know, just before the Slammer outbreak, actually, because it was really spreading very quickly, It was spreading so quickly that when I was ordering French fries in a street food restaurant in Belgium. That was Belgian fries, actually, if you look at Google, in Google. So I was ordering them, and I got a phone call. I got a phone call from our support center. There is something happening over here. Oh, yes? Okay, well, you can wait. I'm just ordering my French fries. So I was ordering my French fries. I got a phone call 5 minutes afterwards. Again, Eddie, we have a serious problem. So I didn't got my French fries. This was a very heavily fast spreading worm. And it was like that after 10 minutes. But did you see this picture? Doesn't it remind you to another picture? This one? Isn't it? Look at this. Look. It was the same thing.
So it happened again?
It happened again. Actually, yes.
But this was not the oldest foulest malware.
No, completely not.
So if you remember 2001, like it was 3 weeks after September the 11th, Nimda. Everybody remembers Nimda? Nimda? Oh, that's... Well, maybe because we're old and we remember. Nimda was actually a piece of malware that spread it in four different ways. And I was running a worm catcher node program from Roger Thompson at that time. And my alarm went off, so I called Roger. Am I the only one seeing it? No, it was over the entire world. And I said, well, Roger only had like the SMB package or the TCP package. I said, well, I have the whole worm. So, and I called it Nimda, just as, because the first thing it was doing was downloading a DOL called admin.dol. So reverse that, Nimda. Was really happy. Everybody in the industry started to use the same name, Nimda. That was quite rare at that moment already, that everybody had the same name. Actually, everybody was happy, almost everybody, except for the Canadian company called Nimda. And then actually, in the end, actually, they sold their domain to Trend Micro. So actually, when you went to nimda.com, actually, you ended up at the Trend Micro page. But we can go further back. Code Red had similar things. So foulest malware is not that new. We hear a lot about it in the stories now, in the news nowadays. But it actually, it has been happening so many times before. And really, if you really want to go back to foulest malware threats, what is the oldest foulest piece of malware? For us, it's Brain, because it was a boot sector, not a foul.
Again.
So nowadays, you hear a lot about rootkits.
Do we? Okay. Well, rootkits, okay. Well, everybody knows where the rootkit is over here, isn't it? Come on, I'm not going to explain that. You are all grown up. But, come on.
Well, the funny thing with rootkits nowadays, we are talking about LoJax, a campaign that changes the EU UEFI. Well, it's really new, of course. I mean, you can see that actually it is like on the top three, or like the top three of like for the Peter Sor Award. But it happened before. Remember CIH? CIH was already breaking BIOSes, but maybe they could also take over a BIOS. We don't know. Actually, quite a lot of systems have like rootkits on them. Like, think about Lenovo.
Yeah. Who has a Lenovo over here?
Oh, me.
Yeah, me too. No, really. I'm asking, who has a Lenovo? Ah, so that's not that much. Well, possibly all the other people don't want to say it, that they have it at home. Yeah, anyway, so if you have a Lenovo, or if you got a Lenovo in the past, well, think about this one. You know, first of all, we got some Superfish malware in 2015, and then we got afterwards, a bootkit over there, and it was very difficult actually to remove it. Okay. That's always the problem with rootkits, isn't it? But anyway, you see, but this is also one example. This is 2015, but we can go much further, of course. Think about 2010, the Stuxnet worm. It was a rootkit. Think about 2009. There we saw the first Mac OS rootkit during Black Hat, one of the Black Hat presentations. And think about that bloody stupid Sony thing. Anybody from Sony over here? I hope not. But anyway, so actually it was kind of legitimate. Well, you know, was it? That's a very big discussion. The problem was that it actually brought rootkits into the lights of everybody. You know, everybody didn't know what a rootkit was after that, more or less. And then the first NT rootkit goes back to 1999. So created by Greg Hoglund, by the way. And actually, that's the guy He's still alive, by the way. But anyway, that's enough for rootkits, isn't it?
That's, yeah.
We should go to something else. Let's go to fishing. And I think everybody knows that this is an old problem. It goes back to, well, it was actually the first fishing technique was described in a paper by the HP user group back in 1987. But the term itself was coined in 1990s. The real thing, the first thing why I still remember fishing mails with it was, of course, the AOL kind of program, which was really hacking into the AOL users group. But that's also a long time ago. And fishing yesterday, it's always about, you know, you know what it means. It's wrong. If you can easily find it, if you see over there, well, sometimes it's very easy to recognize. Sometimes not, because it's of course in an evolution. Of course, you can see if you hover over it, you see it. But still, and well, this is a very interesting one. 90% of men will click on it because we want to see more, isn't it? Yeah, it's statistical. No, you know. I have also another example, but I forgot to include it for the women. But anyway, and this goes on. We have so many examples, but now we changed, isn't it?
Well, we didn't really change.
Well, no, not
because
really.
It's still the same.
It's the same thing.
We started to look at like real applications and fake applications, like they can also be used for phishing. You can actually see, we actually normally make it into a quiz, but you're too smart for that. So we actually put the real one and the fake one right away on the screen. It was really funny to see that. But now we learn that a lot of people are being taught, you have to do additional securing with your banking, two-factor authentication. Who is always suggesting that here to their customers as well? I mean, many people. But the problem is, it's not a problem with two-factor authentication. It's doing two-factor authentication on the same machine you're going to do your banking on. And we already have seen like apps that are now asking for permissions in the latest Google updates, Android updates, they have to ask that for the permission to capture SMSs or other 2FA numbers, so they auto reply. So basically, it can be hijacked. That's a bad thing. I mean, we had this already with an app from a Turkish cryptocurrency. We have a nice blog about that. You can read all about that. It's intercepting the one-time passwords. It's really funny. So I just got a new phone. I had to install a lot of new things. LinkedIn actually says, okay, we will send you the code to verify. It's intercepted. WhatsApp intercepted. And then they automatically install themselves and configure themselves, which is pretty weird. Yeah. So we're making the same mistakes again by giving advice, but not complete advice.
Yeah, it continues.
So it boils down to what humans are doing. Humans are making programs and they create bugs.
That's always the problem. The human factor. Yeah, maybe I'll do another presentation about it later on. But not today, not this year, but later next year. Think about it. But bugs in programming, it's actually a human problem. And we make mistakes. And that's the reason why we have bugs. And actually, that's my impression, that's also the reason why we have exploits. Because an exploit is a piece of software. Look at that. Secrets of Commons that takes advantage of a bug. And a bug is because we make mistakes. Or a vulnerability. Yeah, well, okay, bad programming or whatever. Anyway, so exploit, it's a big problem, of course. But we see a lot of exploit kits, of course. So it's still going on. This is a problem which continues. And, it doesn't only continue, we still have a lot of bugs. And we saw even some presentations over here about exploits as well. Very good presentations. But who knows where bug is coming from? What was the first... Yeah, where is the word bug coming from?
Oh, there, somebody knows.
Yeah, you know it. Well, I think everybody knows that, more or less. You know the story, I see. The faces over here, yeah, that's the story. 1947, Grace Hopper, an electrician, found a moth, a bug, which caused a short circuit on a Harvard Mark III. Two, excuse me.
That's not the oldest book. It existed much earlier. Can you imagine that the word book was actually already invented before computers?
Yeah, yeah. And that's a story that nobody seems to know. Where is the book, the first book, coming from? So nobody did read our paper yet. That's a good thing. Okay, so over here, 1843. Lady Ada Lovelace, a mathematician. Yeah. Well, actually, she was married with,
Lord Byron.
Yeah, exactly. I always forgot his name. Anyway, she invented, actually, the loop. She invented also the algorithm. She was the first to create an algorithm for a computer. And the problem was that there was a bug in that loop. So, yeah, you can look it up. You can find it on the internet. But nobody knows it. So it's fine reading. Try to find it, you know. I like it. I like such kind of historical thing. I'm getting old, I think, you know. Anyway, that's the bad word. I'm going to give it to you now. It's
thank you.
Yeah, I know, but...
GDPR.
I've done too many presentations.
Well, GDPR is, of course, not something that happened before, although... It is connected to what happened before, like we're trying to create privacy. But you know all about GDPR. I don't have to tell you too much about it. So what I'm actually going to do is tell you a little bit about the nasty side effects because of GDPR and the situation we right have now. So as researchers, you all know who is. Right now is a problem. Everything is anonymized, like it's hidden. You cannot see the data anymore. From a research point of view, that's not helping us. We cannot connect things anymore. I cannot do anything about it. It's suddenly the law, GDPR. They are trying to work with it, moving into RDAP, the Registration Data Access Protocol, which is really nice. It's a newer WHOIS, but it still has the same problem. There is no point of contact visible, so that is still an issue. ICANN is reaching out and helping, actually, if people want to help us or help them in fixing this. But I don't think it can be fixed with GDPR in place or GDPR not being altered. And we see some bad things already. We already see blackmail and extortion. Remember, the penalty for GDPR, if you break GDPR, it can be severe, 4% of your annual revenue, or 20 million, whatever is more. So we already have seen attempts, like people are now saying to companies, like, hey, we broke into your network, we see that you're leaking data or not storing everything properly, or you haven't documented it properly. If you're not going to pay me, we will tell the government, and then you have to, 20 million. We see cyber scare. There are web shops right now that are not willing anymore to sell to Europe because of GDPR, because they are storing your information. And the web applications for the web stores, they even have options now, like don't actually allow a checkout when it's to the EU. And another cyber scare, we actually saw how it impacted certification data. We have actually, and we cannot actually show you we have it, but we cannot show it because even the company who wrote that is in the audience. They said, if you remove your account, we will remove every evidence that you had a certification. Which is really weird. So these are really nasty side effects from GDPR.
We should go to the conclusion.
The conclusion is actually, oops, it happened again, which is not Britney Spears. I did it again. That's a completely different thing.
Yeah.
But our hands are sort of tight. It seems like we are tight.
Yeah.
Making the same mistakes over and over. But everything is actually coming back. Whatever we say is new or what the press says, this is new. It happened before. Actually, even yesterday, it was in the news in Belgium. Maybe you don't read the newspaper there. But phishing is a big problem, according to the Belgian government right now.
Yeah, that's what they say.
So we need to go and have some evolution. You can finish.
Yeah, I know, but evolution. You know, that I think we can say so many things about evolution. But I think, you know, if... So I'm not going to say it in words. I'm going to show you a very small fragment of a video that explains it. That's the best thing I can do, I think, because everybody likes it. Let's have a look. You know, this is evolution. This is what we see. This is how it, yeah, there are always, there will be always alternative ways to handle something. Look at it. If you didn't see it, well, I have a repeat option. Unbelievable, isn't it? Yeah. You see, alternative ways, but still evolution. But it's always the same thing, done in a different way, isn't it? Yeah. Well, anyway, we came to our conclusion. Oh, by the way, this is a very secure solution, I think, isn't it?
I actually have a better one.
This one?
No. Anyway, thank you for your attention. If you have questions, we're happy to take them. Actually, the best question, I'm going to say that, the best question, Eddie will give the book away to the one with the best question.
Yes.
If,
there are any questions.